Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining us for our Sunday session. Let's go ahead and have you close your eyes and reflect on your week, the good things that you're grateful for, the negative things that need addressing or healing, and just the neutral things, just the observations. Just close your eyes and just simply reflect. Now, if there's something that you're grateful for, let's go ahead and have you hold that in your heart. Just sit with it. Now sit with a difficulty or negative thing that's happened in the last week. Or if you have something you would like to offer up as a prayer, you can do that. Hold this in your heart. Move your awareness to the top of your head. From the top of your head, gently project upward as high as you can go and for as long as you can hold it. Just project upward. Just be still, be aware. Silently repeat, I am surrounded by the white light of the Lord Christ, of the Lord Buddha, of Rama, of Master Kutumi, of Archangel Michael, only good shall come to me, only good shall go from me. I am surrounded by the white light of the Christ, of the Buddha, of Rama, of Master Kutumi, of Archangel Michael. Only good shall come to me, only good shall go from me. So be it. I give thanks, I give thanks, I give thanks. Great architect of the universe, may I be a channel through which the holy ones approach the world. May I be a center of radiation of thy power. Teach me to travel light, that I may better gain the heights and break the bonds that bind. Teach me to give myself entirely to thy service, to attune myself to thy will. Teach me to lay down the small personal life for the greater cosmic life, and to love with the love of God. Just be still. Great architect of the universe, may I be a channel through which the holy ones approach the world. May I be a center of radiation of thy power. Teach me to travel light, that I may better gain the heights and break the bonds that bind. Teach me to give myself entirely to thy service, to attune myself to thy will. Teach me to lay down the small personal life for the greater cosmic life, and to love with the love of God. Great architect of the universe, may I be a channel through which the holy ones approach the world. May I be a center of radiation of thy power. Teach me to travel light, that I may better gain the heights and break the bonds that bind. Teach me to give myself entirely to thy service, to attune myself to thy will. Teach me to lay down the small personal life for the greater cosmic life, and to love with the love of God. So be it. I turn you over now to Reverend Tammy. Hi, Tammy.
Hello, good morning, everyone. Hello. Maybe afternoon, depends on where you are. It's really good to be together in our Sunday sessions, and I definitely look forward to this all week. You know, in thinking about what we were talking about today, sometimes it's interesting to have spiritual conversations in the context of what's going on in the world. And so much is going on in the world in all spectrums of beingness. And so I was thinking about, I was reading Pema Chodron talking about this idea of an opened, awakened heart. And I had a minister at one point who had written a book called The Open Broken Heart. And so, you know, sometimes when we're in this spiritual path, we may think that sometimes we don't want to be dragged down by the negativity of the world and things like that. And so sometimes, in particularly in people who are engaged in New Thought, we might have a tendency to not be engaged in some of the pain of the world. And I've been thinking about that, and how do we, as people who are in this message, in this time, in this age of Aquarius, how do we relate to things in the world when it doesn't seem to be going exactly how we would have chosen? And so the thing that there were two things kept coming up for me. And one is one of our open, our first conversations when we first started these talks, when we were talking about what is my self-loving choice. But I think that's maybe one of the second steps. One of the first things that kept coming up for me was something that my father used to say all the time. And it was, who owns the problem? So I remember as a person would go to my father and I'd say, and then this happened and that happened and the person did this and that happened. And he would say, who owns the problem? Now, for me, being someone who was naturally empathic, what I had to do was start to learn to separate what was mine versus what belonged to everyone else. So sometimes I remember when I was practicing as an attorney doing domestic violence work. And this is when I really started being able to deal with that idea. Someone would come into my office and they would be feeling out of control, and you know, and I would be in my office feeling fine. And then they would come in and all of a sudden I would be feeling out of control and scared and unsure of what was going on. And I'd be having kind of a panicky feeling. And I thought, that's not mine, right? And so then I remember my father's words, who owns the problem? So the way that we look, so what I would do is I would say, I get that that's the problem they're dealing with. So the idea of who owns the problem helped me be able to identify what was going on with my emotional body and what I was picking up from them. And so that question was really a threshold for how to identify what was mine and what was someone else's. But the inquiry doesn't stop there, right? The idea of who owns the problem could be a way to be a lack of compassion and say, oh, well, that's their problem, right? So we see things going on in the world and we're like, well, that's on them. It's not my problem, it's theirs. So who owns the problem is the first step in a compassion inquiry. Because the next step after who owns the problem is to look at what is the next step for that for me. So once I realized, you know, putting myself back in my office, in my law office, and I'm identifying that the problem that I'm feeling belongs to the client, then because I can feel that, I can then say, you know, checking in, are you feeling insecure? Are you, you know, what is it that you need? Is your safety issue a concern? So that I could address the need, I could be my purpose in that conversation because I first allowed myself to feel it. And then I identified what was mine and what was theirs. And then I could be of service. And that is really the framework that that I've been using ever since. And I wanted to share that because it's actually become kind of unconscious. And I think that a lot of us who are doing this work engage in that same process. We look at what is the problem that's presenting itself in our lives, in the moment, with the people around us. And one of the first steps is identifying what is mine and what is theirs. So a lot of the work that we do is about purifying ourselves of the things in us that would limit our ability to know what is ours and what is someone else's. So often when we have unhealed pain, when someone else is experiencing pain, we start to resonate, we start to add our pain to theirs, and then we are not able to see clearly what they need. We start to react and deal with our own unhealed issue. So an example of that, when you see that happening, is if you were to go to a friend and say, I've had this terrible experience and I went to the grocery store and, you know, someone said something terrible or I saw something terrible. And that person, instead of just being with you, says, oh, I know, I remember when such and such and such happened, right? So that's a clear example of someone who is not dealing with their own pain, but that they're almost projecting and magnifying it to bring it together. So two pain bodies coming together. So when we look at who owns the problem, one of the first steps for me to look at is what about what I'm hearing or seeing is my problem? And what is it that that other person is experiencing? So an example of that is I was reading Pema Chodron was talking about how she had a teacher that when he was younger, he had he was up on a building and he saw these young boys stoning a puppy to death. And he could see the agony of the puppy, and he could see the joy on the face of the young boys that were doing this, and they were just doing it for fun. And he was struck with his own powerlessness to deal with that. And he couldn't get to it in time to stop it. But what he did was he remembered that pain, and that pain of wanting to help people in need was something that he used as fuel to fuel his purpose in life, which was to help people in need, was to help bring love and joy and peace and all of this, you know, as well as service, so that he was actually fulfilling his purpose. But what happens sometimes is when we see something that it seems like we can't do anything about, sometimes we may block ourselves off from it. Right. Sometimes we may say, I'm not going to feel that pain because, you know, I want to be in a higher space of enlightenment. And so what happens is that we start to say who owns the problem. And when we say not me, we're actually missing the mark, because whatever someone else is going through, because we are infinitely connected, we also own that problem. But what we're trying to decide is, where does my ego own the problem, and where does spirit own the situation? And I think there's a difference between those two. So, for example, in the situation of if I have my own pain, then and I'm not willing to face my own pain, if someone else is near me that needs that healing support coming from me, if I can't deal with my own stuff, then I can't deal with theirs. And so often when people are in a time of trouble, they will hear us not be able to be with someone's pain. And sometimes those of us who are engaged in New Age, New Thought beliefs, we'll say things that we think might be comforting, but are things that people are not really ready to hear. So sometimes we may say platitudes like, I had read a book once where the woman had said that her child had died, and there was like a baby. And someone said, oh, well, that was a contract before you came into this life so that you could experience that pain. Or someone would say, oh, it was karmic, or, you know, things like that. And while there may be philosophy that would support that, that's certainly not something that someone would want to hear, especially in that time. So how do we know how to comfort people that are in pain if we can't be with our own pain? And one of the things that came up for me was this idea of just being with people, that so often we don't want people to feel pain. We don't give them permission to experience their own discomfort. And it could be that we're not able to be with our own discomfort. So when someone is in that space, what there is, I think the best thing to do is just sit with them in a space of love, and just permeate the whole energy and create in ourselves the ability to be with their pain, and then transmute it into a higher experience or an expression of love in our own hearts. So, for example, the idea of the teacher that witnessed the puppy being abused, what he did was he transmuted that energy in his heart. He was able to be with it. And then in his heart, he made it give rise to compassion for all living beings, compassion for the people that were missing the mark, compassion for the entire situation, compassion for himself that was not able to step into that situation and stop it. So we actually take the suffering of the world and of ourselves, and we're able to be with the reality of that, and then we're able to transmute it. I'm thinking about Eckhart Tolle in his Transformation of the New Earth book. talking about how we have something called pain bodies, that sometimes we have our individual pain bodies, and we know those, we think of them as, you know, thought forms and things like that, that we may have. And so long as those are not transmuted, they may continue to cause an unconscious reaction, right? So we start being a reaction instead of being active creators in our lives, so long as we're not able to get into the experience of that and then transform it. You know, sometimes when I'm thinking about the what we learn in Astara and what we learn in these new age philosophies and what we learn in new thought, you know, the idea of our thoughts having power and being able to, like, what is the purpose of knowing that I have chakras? What is the purpose of knowing that I have a monad? What is the purpose of knowing that there are all these etheric and spiritual bodies and this physical body lives in that, lives in them? What is the purpose of knowing all of that? And I think the purpose of it is to know that as we transmute, that we have the ability to transmute lower energies into higher energies, knowing that the energy and the consciousness is what is preeminent and most powerful, not the circumstance. So when we understand that we are, that what power of the divine presence that lives in us is greater than circumstances, when we understand that the consciousness and the power of divine that lives in us is is more powerful than anything, then we have no fear. We can walk through the valley of the shadow of death. We can look at the lions in the lion's den. We can look at any circumstance, knowing that this material realm, this grosser reality in which we are playing this game of life, is not absolutely determinative of who we are, that this is the playground in which our spirit is exercising itself. This is the playground. This is the curriculum. This is the school. This is not the actual substance of what has to have the most importance. So because we know this, we can look at the circumstances in the world and have that compassion within ourselves, knowing that compassion is not just sympathy, knowing that our empathy doesn't just give rise to sympathy, but that our compassion is a divine call to action. Our sympathy, our empathy is a divine call. Our compassion is a call to service. And so when we know that, we have a deeper and deeper glimpse of our purpose in this life. We have a deeper glimpse of who we are and what we are about. And we can have compassion for ourselves, knowing that we are all on a journey of life and that we trust the process of our own journey. So as we have forgiveness for ourselves for not being able to save the entire world all at once, we know that what is in front of me is mine to do. So when we ask ourselves, what is the who owns the problem? The answer is always, they do, and I do, and we do. It reminds me of a conversation that happened in the New Testament Bible, when they were asking the idea of what is the fulfillment of all the law and all the prophets. And the answer was, love God and love your neighbor as yourself. So loving God involves loving your neighbor. Loving God involves loving yourself. And they cannot be separated because it is all one. And we know that there is a life presence that is within all things, the life presence that lives inside all of the physical atoms and molecules. We talked about that last week. We know that there is a life presence that binds all things together. And so as we engage in this spiritual quest in this particular lifetime, we align ourselves with all that is. We align ourselves with the love, this powerful presence that the architect of the universe has created within us and created as us. And we know that there is nothing that is greater than this divine presence. So instead of eliminating or closing our heart and avoiding the compassion, we are an open broken heart. And by being with our open, broken heart, we are able to transmute that energy and create something within us so that everything and everyone around us is inside of that transmuted energy. We become a catalyst for a change, not just changing circumstances, but changing consciousness. We are changing not just circumstances, we are changing the very spirit, the very energy, the very vibration, the consciousness of all that is around us. And we actually begin to create a light and a love inside of all that exists and all that exists around us. So just like Arlene Chaney teaches us that if someone is directing hate, we direct love to them. And pretty soon we find that this great river of consciousness, of thought consciousness, starts to flow in the direction of light rather than flowing downstream into the abyss and the swamps of the darkness. All of it exists. All of it exists for us. And if we can remember that everything exists for us, we know that we are in the right place at the right time, that we hear exactly what we need to hear. We know exactly what we know need to know, that every challenge that arises, that there is enough spirit within and around and in my grasp, that anything can be changed for the better and for the higher. And so for that, we can just raise our hearts in gratitude. And so then when we tap our chest and say, what is my self-loving choice? My self-loving choice is to open my heart. My self-loving choice is to open my entire being to the love and the light of all that exists around me, knowing that there is nothing greater than this divine in me. So I just want to leave you all with that. As we go through the week, let's keep this in mind. Who owns the problem? And we just know that there is no such thing as a problem that's greater than God. Namaste. Have a great week.
Thank you, Tammy. Great to hear that that topic. I think it's very timely.
Thank you.
So let's go ahead and have you close your eyes. And let's connect with the divine within. I am that I am. I am that I am. The I am of the incarnated soul is one with the I am of the higher soul. I am that I am. I am not the difficulties of the day. I am not the problems in the world or in society. I am not even the personality. I am not the thoughts, the words, the emotions. I am not even the body. I am the soul. I am that I am. I am not my pain. I'm not the pain of others. I sit with the difficulties in my life, and I choose right thoughts, right words, right actions. I do this by being present. I sit with the pain and difficulties in the world, and I choose right thoughts, right words, right action. Help me to love with the love of God. Help me to be an example. Help me to be a vessel, to bring loving kindness to those who are suffering, to not turn a blind eye. I am that I am. In the Tibetan tradition, the mantra Om Mani Padme Hum has a similar effect to I am that I am. Om Mani Padme Hum. When I see pain in the world, give me the strength of mind to persevere, to do the right thing. To set aside my pain so that I may serve others. Om Mani Padme Om Mani Padme Help me to not lose sight of who I am, to lose sight of my virtues, the cultivation of the virtues. Help me to not lose sight of my morals. Give me the strength of mind to maintain myself in the face of pain and difficulty, be it mine or others. Help me to be a vessel for loving kindness. Om Mani Padme Padme Thank you for joining us on this Sunday session. I hope you were able to find a little bit of insight and a little bit of peace. Maybe spend a few minutes reflecting on some of the words of Reverend Tammy and have a blessed day. From all of us at Astara, we love you and we thank you for joining us. I think we're leaving it open for you to have interactions with Reverend Tammy after this. So if you would like, go ahead and stay on and you can chat with Reverend Tammy. But I hope to see you sometime soon. Take care.